This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Roman roads, Latin, via, singular, via meaning way, were physical infrastructure vital to the maintenance and development of the Roman state, and were built from about 300 BC through the expansion and consolidation of the Roman Republic and the Roman Empire. They provided efficient means for the overland movement of armies, officials, and civilians, and the inland carriage of official communications and trade goods. Roman roads were of several kinds, ranging from small local roads to broad, long-distance highways built to connect cities, major towns, and military bases. These major roads were often stone-paved and metalled, cambered for drainage, and were flanked by footpaths, bridleways, and drainage ditches. They were laid along accurately surveyed courses, and some were cut through hills, or conducted over rivers and ravines on bridgework. Sections could be supported over marshy ground on rafted or piled foundations. At the peak of Rome's development, no fewer than 29 great military highways radiated from the capital, and the late empire's 113 provinces were interconnected by 372 great roads. The whole comprised more than 400,000. Contents 1. Roman systems 2. Laws and traditions 3. Types 31 v. Publicae, consulares, praetoriae and militares 32 v. Privati, rustici, glarii and agrarii 33 v. Vicinalis 34 Governance and financing 35 Costs and civic responsibilities 36 Official bodies 37 Augustus changes 38 Other curators 4 Construction and engineering 41 Practices and terminology 42 Materials and methods 421 Via Terrena 422 Via Glariata 423 Via Moneta 43 Obstacle crossings 44 Bridges and causeways 5 Military and citizen utilization 51 Milestones and markers 52 Itinerary maps and charts 53 Vehicles and transportation 54 Way stations and traveler inns 55 Post offices and services 6 Locations 61 Italian areas 62 Other areas 7 References 71 Footnotes 72 General information 73 Primary sources 8 External links Roman systems. The extraordinary greatness of the Roman Empire manifests itself above all in three things. The aqueducts, the paved roads, and the construction of the drains. Dionysus of Halicarnassus, Ant Rom 3675 Livy mentions some of the most familiar roads near Rome, and the milestones on them, at times long before the first paved road, the Appian Way. Unless these allusions are just simple anachronisms, the roads referred to were probably at the time little more than leveled earthen tracks. Thus, the Via Gabina during the time of Porsena is mentioned in about 500 BC, the Via Latina during the time of Coriolanus in about 490 BC, the Via Nomentana, also known as Via Ficolensis, in 449 BC, the Via Labicana in 421 BC, and the Via Salaria in 361 BC. In the Itinerary of Antoninus, the description of the road system, after the death of Julius Caesar and during the tenure of Augustus, is as follows, with the exception of some outlying portions, such as Britain north of the Wall, Dacia, and certain provinces east of the Euphrates. The whole empire was penetrated by these itinera plural of iter. There is hardly a district to which we might expect a Roman official to be sent, on service either civil or military, where we do not find roads. They reach the wall in Britain, run along the Rhine, the Danube, and the Euphrates, and cover, as with a network, the interior provinces of the empire. A road map of the empire reveals that it was generally laced with a dense network of prepared V. Beyond its borders there were no paved roads, however, it can be supposed that footpaths and dirt roads allowed some transport. There were, for instance, some pre-Roman ancient trackways in Britain, such as the Ridgeway and the Icknield Way for specific roads. See Roman road locations below. Laws and traditions. The laws of the 12 tables, dated to about 450 BC, specified that a road shall be 8. Restricted commercial carts to nighttime access in the city within the walls and within a mile outside the walls. Types Roman roads varied from simple corduroy roads to paved roads using deep roadbeds of tamped rubble as an underlying layer to ensure that they kept dry, as the water would flow out from between the stones and fragments of rubble, instead of becoming mud in clay soils. According to Ulpian, there were three types of roads, v. Publicae, consulares, praetoriae or militares, v. Privati, rustici, glarii or agrarii, v. vicinalis v publicae, consulares, praetoriae and militares. The first type of road included public high or main roads, constructed and maintained at the public expense, and with their soil vested in the state. Such roads led either to the sea, or to a town, or to a public river, one with a constant flow, or to another public road. Siculus Flaccus, who lived under Trajan 98-117, calls them v publicae regalesque, and describes their characteristics as follows: they are placed under curators commissioners, and repaired by redemptors contractors at the public expense, a fixed contribution, however, being levied from the neighboring landowners. These roads bear the names of their constructors, e.g. Via Appia, Cassia, Flaminia. Roman roads were named after the censor who had ordered their construction or reconstruction. The same person often served afterwards as consul, but the road name is dated to his term as censor if the road was older than the office of censor or was of unknown origin. It took the name of its destination or of the region through which it mainly passed. A road was renamed if the censor ordered major work on it, such as paving, repaving, or rerouting, with the term v regales. Compare the roads of the Persian kings, who probably organized the first system of public roads, and the king's highway with the term v militaria. Compare the Icnield way, e.g., Icen Hild Weg, or war way of the Iceni. However, there were many other people, besides special officials, who from time to time, and for a variety of reasons, sought to connect their names with a great public service like that of the roads. Gaius Gracchus, when tribune of the people 123-122 BC, paved or graveled many of the public roads, and provided them with milestones and mounting blocks for riders. Again, Gaius Scribonius Curio, when tribune 50 BC, sought popularity by introducing a lex viaria, under which he was to be chief inspector or commissioner for 5 years. Dio Cassius mentions as one of the forcible acts of the triumvirs of 43 BC Octavianus, Antony, and Lepidus, that they obliged the senators to repair the public roads at their own expense. V. Privati, Rustici, Glarii and Agrarii. The second category included private or country roads, originally constructed by private individuals, in whom their soil was vested, and who had the power to dedicate them to the public use. Such roads benefited from a right-of-way, in favor either of the public or of the owner of a particular estate. Under the heading of V. Privati were also included roads leading from the public or high roads to particular estates or settlements. These Ulpian considers to be public roads themselves. Features off the via were connected to the via by V. Rustici, or secondary roads. Both main or secondary roads might either be paved, or left unpaved, with a gravel surface, as they were in North Africa. These prepared but unpaved roads were V. Glarii or Sternendae, to be strewn. Beyond the secondary roads were the V. Terranae, dirt roads. V. Vicinalis. The third category comprised roads at or in villages, districts, or crossroads, leading through or towards a vicus or village. Such roads ran either into a high road, or into other V. Vicinalis, without any direct communication with a high road. They were considered public or private, according to the fact of their original construction. Out of public or private funds or materials, such a road, though privately constructed, became a public road when the memory of its private constructors had perished. Remarodst ML. Siculus Flaccus describes V. Vicinalis's roads, de publicis quae divertunt in agros et sape ad alteras publicas pervenient, which turn off the public roads into fields, and often reach to other public roads. The repairing authorities, in this case, were the magistri pejorum or magistrates of the cantons. They could require the neighboring landowners either to furnish laborers for the general repair of the V. Vicinalis, or to keep in repair, at their own expense, a certain length of road passing through their respective properties. Governance and financing. With the conquest of Italy, prepared V were extended from Rome and its vicinity to outlying municipalities, sometimes overlying earlier roads. Building V was a military responsibility and thus came under the jurisdiction of a consul. The process had a military name, Via Munir, as though the via were a fortification. Municipalities, however, were responsible for their own roads, which the Romans called V. Vicinalis. The beauty and grandeur of the roads might tempt us to believe that any Roman citizen could use them for free, but this was not the case. Tolls abounded, especially at bridges. Often they were collected at the city gate. Freight costs were made heavier still by import and export taxes. These were only the charges for using the roads. Costs of services on the journey went up from their financing. Road building was a Roman government responsibility. Maintenance, however, was generally left to the province. The officials tasked with fundraising were the curators viarum. They had a number of methods available to them. Private citizens with an interest in the road could be asked to contribute to its repair. High officials might distribute largesse to be used for road censors, who were in charge of public morals and public works, were expected to fund repairs sua pecunia with their own money beyond those means. Taxes were required of via connected two cities v were generally centrally placed in the countryside. The construction and care of the public roads, whether in Rome, in Italy, or in the provinces, was, at all periods of Roman history, considered to be a function of the greatest weight and importance. This is clearly shown by the fact that the censors, in some respects the most venerable of Roman magistrates, had the earliest paramount authority to construct and repair all roads and streets. Indeed, all the various functionaries, not excluding the emperors themselves, who succeeded the censors in this portion of their duties, may be said to have exercised a devolved censorial jurisdiction. Costs and civic responsibilities. The devolution to the censorial jurisdiction soon became a practical necessity, resulting from the growth of the Roman dominions and the diverse labors which detained the censors in the capital city. Certain ad hoc official bodies successively acted as constructing and repairing authorities in Italy. The censorial responsibility passed to the commanders of the Roman armies, and later to special commissioners, and in some cases perhaps to the local magistrates in the provinces. The consul or praetor and his legates received authority to deal directly with the contractor. The care of the streets and roads within the Roman territory was committed in the earliest times to the censors. They eventually made contracts for paving the street inside Rome, including the Clivus Capitolinus, with lava, and for laying down the roads outside the city with gravel. Sidewalks were also provided the aediles, probably by virtue of their responsibility for the freedom of traffic and policing the streets. Co-operated with the censors and the body that succeeded them, it would seem that in the reign of Claudius AD 41-54 the quaestors had become responsible for the paving of the streets of Rome, or at least shared that responsibility with the quatuorviri viarum. It has been suggested that the quaestors were obliged to buy their right to an official career by personal outlay on the streets. There was certainly no lack of precedents for this enforced liberality, and the change made by Claudius may have been a mere change in the nature of the expenditure imposed on the quaestors' official bodies. The official bodies which first succeeded the censors in the care of the streets and roads were two in number. They were quatuorviri viis in urba pergandis, with jurisdiction inside the walls of Rome; duoviri viis extra urbum pergandis, with jurisdiction outside the walls. Both these bodies were probably of ancient origin, but the true year of their institution is unknown. Little reliance can be placed on Pomponius, who states that the quatuorviri were instituted eadem temporis at the same time as the praetor peregrinus, i.e. about 242 BC, and the decemviri litibus judicandis, time unknown. The first mention of either body occurs in the Lex Julia Municipalis of 45 BC. The quatuorviri were afterwards called quatuorviri viarum curandarum. The extent of jurisdiction of the duoviri is derived from their full title as duoviri viis extra propiusve urbum Romum passus mill pergandis. Their authority extended over all roads between their respective gates of issue in the city wall and the first milestone beyond in case of an emergency in the condition of a particular road. Men of influence and liberality were appointed, or voluntarily acted, as curators or temporary commissioners to superintend the work of repair. The dignity attached to such a curatorship is attested by a passage of Cicero. Among those who performed this duty in connection with particular roads was Julius Caesar, who became curator 67 BC of the Via Appia, and spent his own money liberally upon it. Certain persons appear also to have acted alone and taken responsibility for certain roads in the country districts. As has been stated, the magistri pejorum had authority to maintain the V vicinalis in Rome itself. Each householder was legally responsible for the repairs to that portion of the street which passed his own house. It was the duty of the aediles to enforce this responsibility. The portion of any street which passed a temple or public building was repaired by the aediles at the public expense. When a street passed between a public building or temple and a private house, the public treasury and the private owner shared the expense equally, no doubt, if only to secure uniformity. The personal liability of householders to execute repairs of the streets was commuted for a paving rate payable to the public authorities who were responsible from time to time. Augustus changes. The governing structure was changed by Augustus in the course of his reconstitution of the urban administration. He created new offices in connection with the public works, streets, and aqueducts of Rome. He found the quatuorviri and duoviri forming part of the body of magistrates known as vigintisexviri. These he reduced from 26 to 20 members vigintiviri, but retained the quatuorviri among them. The latter were certainly still in existence under Hadrian 117-138 Augustus abolished the duoviri, no doubt because the time had come to deal comprehensively with the superintendence of the roads which connected Rome with Italy and the provinces. Dio Cassius relates that Augustus personally accepted the post of superintendent in this capacity. He represented the paramount authority which belonged originally to the censors. Moreover, he appointed men of praetorian rank to be road makers, assigning to each of them two lictors. He also made the office of curator of each of the great public roads a perpetual magistracy, instead of a special and temporary commission, as had been the case hitherto. In Augustus' capacity as supreme head of the public road system, he converted the temporary cura of each of the great roads into a permanent magistracy. The persons appointed under the new system were of senatorial or equestrian rank, according to the relative importance of the roads respectively assigned to them. It was the duty of each curator to issue contracts for the maintenance and repairs of his road, and to see that the contractor who undertook the work performed it faithfully, as to both quantity and quality. Moreover, he authorized the construction of sewers and removed obstructions to traffic, as the aediles did in Rome. It was in the character of an imperial curator, though probably of one armed with extraordinary powers, that Corbulo, as has been already mentioned, denounced the magistratus and mancipes of the Italian roads to Tiberius. He pursued them and their families with fines and imprisonment for 18 years AD 21-39, and was rewarded with a consulship by Caligula, who was himself in the habit of condemning well-born citizens to work on the roads. It is noticeable that Claudius brought Corbulo to justice, and repaid the money which had been extorted from his victims. Other curators, special curators for a term, seem to have been appointed on occasion, even after the institution of the permanent magistrates bearing that title. The emperors who succeeded Augustus exercised a vigilant control over the condition of the public highways. Their names occur frequently in the inscriptions to restorers of roads and bridges. Thus, Vespasian, Titus, Domitian, Trajan, and Septimius Severus were commemorated in this capacity at Emerita. The Itinerary of Antoninus, which was probably a work of much earlier date, republished in an improved and enlarged form, under one of the Antonine emperors, remains as standing evidence of the minute care which was bestowed on the service of the public roads construction and engineering. Ancient Rome boasted impressive technological feats, using many advances that would be lost in the Middle Ages. These accomplishments would not be rivaled until the modern age. Many practical Roman innovations were adopted from earlier designs. Some of the common, earlier designs incorporated arches, road construction on Trajan's column, practices and terminology. Main article, Roman engineering. Roman road builders aimed at a regulation width. See laws and standards above, but actual widths have been measured at between 36. Today, the concrete has worn from the spaces around the stones, giving the impression of a very bumpy road, but the original practice was to produce a surface that was no doubt much closer to being flat. Many roads were built to resist rain, freezing and flooding. They were constructed to need as little repair as possible. Roman construction took a directional straightness. Many long sections are ruler straight, but it should not be thought that all of them were. Some links in the network were as long as 55 miles 89. Divided them up in the following fashion: via terrena, a plain road of leveled earth; via glariata, an earthed road with a graveled surface; via manita, a regular built road, paved with rectangular blocks of the stone of the country, or with polygonal blocks of lava. The Romans, though certainly inheriting some of the art of road construction from the Etruscans, borrowed the knowledge of construction of via munitae from the Carthaginians. According to Isidore of Seville, via terrena, the via terrenae were plain roads of leveled earth. These were mere tracks worn down by the feet of humans and animals, and possibly by wheeled carriages. Via glariata, the via glariatae were earthed roads with a graveled surface or a gravel subsurface and paving on top. Livy speaks of the censors of his time as being the first to contract for paving the streets of Rome with flint stones, for laying gravel on the roads outside the city, and for forming raised footpaths at the sides. In these roads, the surface was hardened with gravel, and although pavements were introduced shortly afterwards, the blocks were allowed to rest merely on a bed of small stones. An example of this type is found on the Prenestine Way. Another example is found near the Via Latina. Via Manita, the best sources of information as regards the construction of a regulation via Manita are the many existing remains of Via Publicae. These are often sufficiently well preserved to show that the rules of construction were, as far as local material allowed, minutely adhered to. In practice, the directions for making pavements given by Vitruvius, the pavement and the Via Manita were identical in construction, except as regards the top layer, or surface. This consisted, in the former case, of marble or mosaic, brick, and, in the latter, of blocks of stone or lava. A passage in Statius describing the repairs of the Via Domitiana, a branch road of the Via Appia, leading to Neapolis after the civil engineer looked over the site of the proposed road and determined roughly where it should go, the agrimensors went to work surveying the road bed. They used two main devices, the rod and a device called a gromma, which helped them obtain right angles. The grommatici, the Roman equivalent of rod men, placed rods and put down a line called the rigor, as they did not possess anything like a transit. A civil engineering surveyor tried to achieve straightness by looking along the rods and commanding the grommatici to move them as required. Using the grommae, they then laid out a grid on the plan of the road. The liberators then began their work using plows and, sometimes with the help of legionaries, with spades excavated the road bed down to bed rock, or at least to the firmest ground they could find. The excavation was called the fossa, the Latin word for ditch. The depth varied according to terrain. The general appearance of such a metalled road and footway is shown in an existing street of Pompeii. A native earth, leveled and, if necessary, rammed tight. B statuemen, stones of a size to fill the hand. C audits, rubble or concrete of broken stones and lime. D nucleus, kernel or bedding of fine cement made of pounded potsherds and lime. E dorsum or agger. V the elliptical surface or crown of the road. Media strata eminentia made of polygonal blocks of silex basaltic lava or rectangular blocks of saxum chitidratum travertine, peperino, or other stone of the country. The upper surface was designed to cast off rain or water like the shell of a tortoise. The lower surfaces of the separate stones, here shown as flat, were sometimes cut to a point or edge in order to grasp the nucleus, or next layer, more firmly. F crepido, margo or semida, raised footway, or sidewalk, on each side of the via. G umbones or edge stones. The method varied according to geographic locality, materials available and terrain, but the plan, or ideal at which the engineer aimed, was always the same. The roadbed was layered. The road was constructed by filling the ditch. This was done by layering rock over other stones. Into the ditch was dumped large amounts of rubble, gravel and stone, whatever fill was available. Sometimes a layer of sand was put down, if it could be found. When it came to within 1 yard, 1 meter or so of the surface, it was covered with gravel and tamped down, a process called paviae, or pavimentare. The flat surface was then the pavimentum. It could be used as the road, or additional layers could be constructed. A statuemen or foundation of flat stones set in cement might support the additional layers. The final steps utilized lime-based concrete, which the Romans had discovered. They seemed to have mixed the mortar and the stones in the ditch. First a small layer of coarse concrete, the rudis, then a little layer of fine concrete, the nucleus, went onto the pavement or statuemen. Into or onto the nucleus went a course of polygonal or square paving stones, called the summa crusta. The crusta was crowned for drainage. An example is found in an early basalt road by the Temple of Saturn on the Clivus Capitolinus. It had travertine paving, polygonal basalt blocks, concrete bedding substituted for the gravel, and a rain water gutter. The remains of Emperor Trajan's route along the Danube. See Roman Serbia. Roman auxiliary infantry crossing a river, probably the Danube, on a pontoon bridge during the Emperor Trajan's Dacian Wars. 101-106 obstacle crossings. Romans preferred to engineer solutions to obstacles rather than circumvent them. Outcroppings of stone, ravines, or hilly or mountainous terrain called for cuttings and tunnels. An example of this is found on the Roman road from Cazanes near the Iron Gates. This road was half carved into the rock, about 5 with stone, and had the arch as its basic structure. See arch bridge. Most also used concrete, which the Romans were the first to use for bridges. Roman bridges were so well constructed that a number remain in use today. Causeways were built over marshy ground. The road was first marked out with pilings. Between them were sunk large quantities of stone so as to raise the causeway to more than 5,150. Monument on it were listed all the major cities in the empire and distances to them. Constantine called it the Umbilicus Romae, Navel of Rome, and built a similar, although more complex, monument in Constantinople. The Million Milestones permitted distances and locations to be known and recorded exactly. It was not long before historians began to refer to the milestone at which an event occurred. Itinerary maps and charts. Main article, Itinerarium Tabula Peutingeriana. Southern Italy centered combined topographical and road maps may have existed as specialty items in some Roman libraries, but they were expensive, hard to copy, and not in general use. Travelers wishing to plan a journey could consult an itinerarium, which in its most basic form was a simple list of cities and towns along a given road, and the distances between them. It was only a short step from lists to a master list, or a schematic route planner in which roads and their branches were represented more or less in parallel, as in the Tabula Peutingeriana. From this master list, parts could be copied and sold on the streets. The most thorough used different symbols for cities, way stations, water courses, and so on. The Roman government from time to time would produce a master road itinerary. The first known were commissioned in 44 BC by Julius Caesar and Mark Antony. Three Greek geographers, Xenodoxus, Theodotus and Polyclitus, were hired to survey the system and compile a master itinerary. The task required over 25 years, and the resulting stone-engraved master itinerary was set up near the Pantheon. Travelers and itinerary sellers could make copies from it. Vehicles and transportation. Roman carriage reconstruction. Outside the cities, Romans were avid riders and rode on or drove quite a number of vehicle types, some of which are mentioned here. Carts driven by oxen were used. Horse-drawn carts could travel up to 40 to 50 kilometers, 25 to 31. A gig was open above and in front and had a seat drawn by one or two mules or horses. It was used for cab work, the cab drivers being called Siziani. The builder was a Cisarius of the coaches. The mainstay was the rheda or rheda, which had four wheels. The high sides formed a sort of box in which seats were placed, with a notch on each side for entry. It carried several people with baggage up to the legal limit of 1,000 Roman lebrae pounds, modern equivalent 327. Way stations and traveler inns. See also, Mancio. Non-military officials and people on official business had no legion at their service, and the government maintained way stations, or mansiones, staying places, for their use. Passports were required for identification. Mansiones were located about 25 to 30 kilometers, 16 to 19. A third system of way stations serviced vehicles and animals, the mutationes, changing stations. They were located every 20 to 30 kilometers, 12 to 19. There are many examples of roads that still follow the route of Roman roads. Italian areas. Italian and Sicilian roads in the time of ancient Rome. Major roads. Via Emilia, from Rimini Ariminum to Placentia. Via Appia, the Appian Way, 312 BC, from Rome to Apulia. Via Aurelia, 241 BC, from Rome to France. Via Cassia, from Rome to Tuscany. Via Flaminia, 220 BC, from Rome to Rimini Ariminum. Via Raetia, from Verona north across the Brenner Pass. Via Salaria, from Rome to the Adriatic Sea in the Marches. Others. Via Emilia Scari, 109 BC. Via Aquileia, branches off the Appia at Capua to the sea at Vibo. Via Amarina, from Rome to Ameria and Perusia. Via Canalis, from Udine, Ge Mona and Valcanali to Philoc in Carinthia, and then over Alps to Salzburg or Vienna. Via Claudia Julia Augusta, 13 BC. Via Claudia Nova, 47 AD. Via Clodia, from Rome to Tuscany, forming a system with the Cassia. Via Domitiana, coast road from Naples to Formia. Via Flavia, from Trieste Tergest to Dalmatia. Via Gemina, from Aquileia and Trieste through the Carse to Materia, Obrov, Lipa and Clana, from where, near Rijeka, descending towards Trsat Tersatica to continue along the Dalmatian coast. Via Julia Augusta, 8 BC, exits Aquileia. Via Labacana, southeast from Rome, forming a system with the Prenestina. Via Ostiensis, from Rome to Ostia. Via Postumia, 148 BC, from Aquileia through Verona across the Apennines to Genoa. Via Papilia, 132 BC, two distinct roads, one from Capua to Regium and the other from Ariminum through the later Veneto region. Via Prenestina, from Rome to Prenestae. Via Slavonia, from Aquileia across northern Istria to Senj and into Dalmatia. Via Severiana, Terracina to Ostia. Via Tiburtina, from Rome to Aeternum. Via Traiana Nova, Italy, from Lake Bolsena to the Via Cassia, known by archaeology only. Other areas. Africa. Main article, Roman roads in Africa. Main road, from Sala Colonia to Carthage to Alexandria in Egypt, via Hadriana in Mauritania. Tingitana, from Tingis southward. See, Roman roads in Morocco. A road in Histria Sino presumed to be of Roman origin. The rectangular blocks are not true Roman construction. Albania, Republic of Macedonia, Greece, Turkey. Via Ignatia, 146 BC, connecting Dyrrhachium on Adriatic Sea to Byzantium. Via Thessaloniki, Austria, Serbia, Bulgaria, Turkey. Via Militaris. Via Diagonalis, via Singidunum, connecting Middle Europe and Byzantium. Roman road in Cilicia in South Turkey. France. In France, a Roman road is called Voie Romaine in vernacular language. Via Agrippa. Via Aquitania, from Narbonne, where it connected to the Via Domitia, to the Atlantic Ocean. Across Toulouse and Bordeaux. Via Domitia, 118 BC, from Nimes to the Pyrenees, where it joins to the Via Augusta at the Col de Panissars. Voie Romaine, extending from Dunkirk to Kassel in Nord département. Major Roman roads in Germania. Inferior Germania. Inferior Germany, Belgium, Netherlands. Via Belgica. Boulogne. Cologne. Lower Limes Germanicus. Interconnections between Lower Limes Germanicus and Via Belgica. Middle East. Via Maris. Via Traiana Nova. Petra. Roman road. 1st century Petra, Jordan. Roman road. roads along the Danube-Romania Trajan's Bridge and Iron Gates Road via Traiana, Porolism Napoca Potaisa Apulum Road via Pontica, Trosmis Piroborodova Caput Stenarum Apulum Partiscum Lugio. Romania, Bulgaria via Pontica Roman roads in Hispania, or Roman Iberia Roman road in the urban fabric of Tarsus, Mersin province in Turkey Spain and Portugal Eider ab Emerita Asturicam, from Sevilla to Gijón later known as Via de la Plata Plata means silver in Spanish, but in this case it is a false cognate of an Arabic word balada, part of the fan of the Way of St. James. Now it is the A66 freeway Via Augusta, from Cadiz to the Pyrenees, where it joins to the Via Domitia at the Col de Panissars. Near La Jonquera it passes through Valencia, Tarragona anciently Tarraco, and Barcelona Camino de Oro, ending in Orense, capital of the province of Orense, passing near the village of Rebolito. Trans-Alpine roads. These roads connected modern Italy and Germany via Claudia Augusta 47 from Altinum now Quarto d'Edino to Augsburg via the Rhaetian Pass via Mala from Milan to Lindau via the San Bernardino Pass. Via Decia Trans-Pyrenean roads connecting Hispania and Gallia, A flat Asturica Berdigilam High Street, a fell in the English Lake District, named after the Roman road which runs over the summit, is the highest Roman road in Britain. United Kingdom main article, Roman roads in Britain. Aikman Street, Camlet Way, Deer Street, Ermine Street, Fen Causeway, Fosse Way, King Street, London. West of England Roman roads, Petters Way, Pye Road, Stane Street, Chichester, Stane Street, Colchester, Stangate, Via Divana, Watling Street. References. Footnotes. Carat Forbes, Robert James, Chapter 1993, Studies in Ancient Technology, Volume 2, Brill p. Carat Duduku, Gem 2015, The Romans in 100 Facts, GL 54EP UK, Amberley Publishing, ISBN. Carat Lawrence, Ray 1999, The Roads of Roman Italy, Mobility and Cultural Change, Routage pp. Black, 1892, page 251. Carat Jas Elsner, The Itinerarium Berdigalens, Politics and Salvation in the Geography of Constantine's Empire, Journal of Roman Studies, 2000, pp. 181-195, p. 184. Carat Travel in the Ancient World, Lionel Casson, p. 189. Carat Naturalis Historia by Gaius Plinius Secundus, Liber 7, 84. Carat The General History of the Highways by Nicholas Bergier, page 156. Carat Cajeliot, New Evidence for the Speed of the Roman Imperial Post, Phoenix 9, 2, 1955, 76 ff. Carat The Archaeological Site of Histria, Archwebsimicro. General Information. Lawrence, Ray 1999, The Roads of Roman Italy, Mobility and Cultural Change. Routledge. Von Hagen, Victor W. 1967, The Roads That Led to Rome. The World Publishing Company, Cleveland and New York. Codrington, Thomas 1905, Roman Roads in Britain. London, Society for Promoting Christian Knowledge. Forbes, Urquhart A., and Arnold C. Burmister 1904, Our Roman Highways. London, F. E. Robinson. Co. Roby, Henry John. Chapter 1902, Roman Private, Law in the Times of Cicero and of the Antonines. Cambridge, Cup Smith, William Waite, and G. E. Marendon 1890, A Dictionary of Greek and Roman Antiquities. London, J. Murray, page 946-954. Smith, William 1858, A School Dictionary of Greek and Roman Antiquities, abridged from the larger dictionary by William Smith, with corrections and improvements by Charles Anthon N.Y., page 354-355. Crecy, Edward 1847, An Encyclopedia of Civil Engineering, Historical, Theoretical, and Practical. London, printed for Longman, Brown, Green, and Longmans. Paternoster Row. Primary sources. Siculus Flaccus, De Conditionibus Agrorum Cap 19. Isidori Hispalensis Episcopi Etymologiarum Sive Originum Liber 15, 15-16. Codex Theodosianus, 85. De Cursu Publico Angaris et Peringaris, 153. De Itinere Muniendo Corpus Iuris Civilis C. 1250. De Cursu Publico Angaris et Peringaris.